Good morning, everyone. Look, I'll get underway if I can. Welcome to come here this morning. Thank you very much. And for those people out in the regions who are tuning in this morning. I've titled this session, Possibility Thinking. And so I want to start with an activity for you guys. And I'm going to ask you to stand on your feet, please. Everybody up. Now, what I have to explain this for you guys in the room here, but also for those people out in the regions. If I can just demonstrate what I'm going to ask you to do. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to put your hand up in front of you. Okay, and what I'll get you to do then is to come around and get a mark on the wall that's comfortable for you. Okay, then you'll come back and you put your hand down to your side. And then we're going to do a couple of times in our imagination and just see what happens. For those people who are out there in the regions, I really would encourage you to actually participate in this, just so we talk about conscious convinces later on, just so you can understand just what I'm and the process of what I'm talking about. So if we can ask you folks just to put your hand up in front of you, okay, and I'll just get you to come around, please. Come around and get a mark on the wall that's comfortable for you. And you got that mark? And then just get you to come back. Okay? And then I'll get you to put your hand down to your side. So this time I'm going to ask you to do this three times in your imagination. So I'm just going to ask you to close your eyes, okay, and just imagine that your arm is coming up in front of you, okay, but you're feeling really loose and flexible now. And I want you just to imagine your hand coming around, coming around, coming around, coming around, coming around, to pass your first mark to a brand new mark, well beyond that. Then I'm going to ask you just to come back, 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 hands down to your side. Again, with your eyes closed and your imagination again, just imagine your body getting really loose and flexible now, really loose and flexible. I want you just then to imagine your arm up in front of you again, just coming around, coming around, coming around, coming around, coming around, coming around that first mark. And just imagine yourself getting to a new mark. And then well beyond that second mark to a brand new mark where body's really loose and flexible, really loose like a top. And then just coming back, 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 hands down to your side. Then I'll ask you just put your hand up in front of you, please. Eyes open. And I'd just like you to come round, please, and get your new mark. And just come back. Can I just ask, who got a new mark then? That'll be on that first mark. Okay, excellent. Okay, sit yourselves down. Okay. What I'm on about today is exactly that, is how we use our thinking to extend ourselves much further than we ever thought possible, both for ourselves as educators and also how we can take our students to that new realm of possibilities. Okay. In doing that, I'm going to take you on a journey this morning. And I want to start that journey with a concept that comes from Edward de Bono's work in lateral thinking. Are you aware of de Bono? When they talk about think outside the box, think laterally. Okay. One of the things that he talks about here is what's called the knowledge trap. And he's saying this knowledge trap is what stops our ability to think laterally and look at opportunities rather than just daunted by challenges. Huh? I then want to look at taking what de Bono's talks about is how our past thinking and past experiences can really influence positively and also can sabotage our best efforts of where we want to go. Okay, and so I'm going to be saying to you guys as educators, it's your students in front of you have had past experience of education. And what can we do there ourselves to kind of challenge them to look at opportunity, look at possibilities of their own skills and be open to new ideas. And the next thing I want them to look at is that when we've got this here is our goals that we want. And we either achieve those goals with our thinking or we can sabotage ourselves. So I want to have a look what that actually means and how our words actually affect our bodies. Okay. I then want to look at a process here of focus. So here's the archer, and we have here the arrow. And again, I want to take you through a process of what we call conscious convinces, of just seeing what happens as where we put our focus. Because what happens when we put our, what we put our focus on is where our energy goes. Okay, and I want to demonstrate that with you and just help you understand how you might do that with your students. help them get that focus positive and towards the goals they want to achieve. Okay. I then want to make sure that this stuff today has relevance to you. Okay, whether you are face-to-face delivery, whether you've got online delivery, whatever your opportunity is with your students, but also I would hope that this has got a real relevance in your own life. Would I be right in saying that you guys have been through a little bit of change lately over the last few years? Have you ever had any restructures here in West Australia? Like, if Queensland, we've just had so many. Okay, so you've got to be flexible. And flexibility is really about thinking as well. So let's start with De Bono's work. Now, those of you who have got the book that's in front of you, okay, if you open those up, this first page here, which we call the knowledge trap. Now, there is a lot of examples of Edward De Bono's work throughout the world. The one that I love best is the one you'll see in any high-rise building throughout the world. As soon as you go to the high-rise building, you go and see the lifts. And outside the lifts are examples of Edward De Bono's work. As soon as you get to the lifts, you'll see mirrors on the outside of the lifts. When you get inside the lifts, you'll see mirrors there as well. Now, if you aren't aware of that, you will be from now on. Now, what's that got to do with today? Well, it was now 39 years ago. There was a 47-story building built in New York, and the owners of the building were getting complaints from their tenants that their employees could not get out of the building fast enough in the afternoon at knock-off time. And they're actually threatening to withdraw from their leases. Now, if you own a 47-story building, you can't have it empty. They looked at all the possibilities of getting the lifts going faster. They exhausted the engineering possibilities. Then they thought, okay, if we put new lift wells down, that could be a solution. Well, 47 stories of concrete, you can't do that structurally. So they thought, okay, we put lifts on the outside of the building, that's a solution. Well, if you've been in New York, you'll know that most of the buildings are up against each other, so that's not going to happen. So they got De Bono in. Apparently he walked to the building, talked to people, observed what was happening, came back to the owners and said, I want you to put mirrors on the outside of your lifts. And they said, well, why would you do that? He said, put the mirrors there, let's see what happens. They put the mirrors there. Within 3 to 6 months, the complaints virtually went to zero. And they got the guy back and they said, how on earth could mirrors possibly make lifts go faster? There's no complaints anymore. And he said, well, of course they didn't. He said, but you're looking at the wrong answer, and the wrong question. He said, the real problem was not the speed of the lifts. He said, the real problem was the people were bored. And he said, what better way to fix boredom? Put a mirror there. Either preen yourself in the mirror or have a good look on the body next door without getting caught. It's a very practical way of getting over boredom. Now, I was actually in Brisbane, where I come from, about 6 months ago. I was in the inner city building, and the lift stopped at the third floor. And this lady got in. She immediately swung to the mirror and started to adjust her scarf. I thought, well, that's exactly what De Bono is talking about, you know? Now, most people thought she was would presume she was preening herself. I knew she was looking at my body. I wish. we can all dream. Now, one of the things he says here, the more knowledgeable you are about something, the less likely you are to be a good thinker. Because as soon as you specialise in something, that may be brake mechanics, hairdressing, nuclear physics, he says, as soon as you put a hole of your time into something, a lot of your thinking, a lot of your energy, he says, there is a danger that you're going to make this statement. And De Bono would say this would have to be the most dangerous statement anyone could ever possibly make. And the statement's this: I'm right. He says, as soon as you say, I'm right, you've stopped your ability to think. He says, look, I've been at this game for 10 years, I've done this. We start to defend ourselves and defend our position. As soon as we do that, it's like the blinker's gone. When the blinker's gone, then it's very difficult to be open to new ideas because we've started to invest. Can I give you the example here, folks, of a country road? Driving along this country road, and all of a sudden we've come to a wider section. First thought is, you know, do I go left, do I go right? No one's told me. You know, am I on the right road? Well, yes, I'm on the right road. There's been enough landmark, definitely on the right road, but which way do I go? So eventually we've got to make the decision. Now, let's say we decide to go up here. De Bono says that most people just don't decide to travel that road and see where it leads. He says we get to about this point here, and then we start coming up with all the reasons why this road here had to be the wrong road. We'll talk about the wear and tear and the bitumen, all sorts of crazy stuff to justify ourselves. Then we get a little bit further, and there really is a roadblock. then it's very difficult to come up here, okay, because we've started to invest. Okay. Now, he says that if you want to be a good thinker, you've got to be aware of what he calls the laws of thinking. Okay, so I'll just put these down here. This is what he calls law one, our laws. Now, law one is that your, law one says that your current view of any situation never, ever, ever equals a better view of the situation. Now, I'm going to abbreviate that down. Your CVS never, ever, ever equals BVS, the better view. What I mean there is that no matter what you currently think, there is always out there another way of thinking about it. But what happens to us? We get stuck. Can I give you the analogy here of noughts and crosses? Most of you would have played noughts and crosses, I presume, when you were kids. Can anyone remember having a favourite way of playing noughts and crosses? Yeah, okay. You'll either be, in my experience, either a middle person or a corner person, okay? I'm dead set a corner person because I know that if I put my cross here, provided my opponent puts a zero there, I have got it won. There is no way in the world they'll beat me the minute that zero's gone there. If they put that zero anywhere else in the grid, I'm going to play for a draw and hopefully catch you next time. Are you aware of that sort of thinking? Okay, folks, how many ways do you reckon there are to play noughts and crosses? How many ways do you reckon you could play at noughts and crosses? Anyone like to start the bidding for me? It's a chance to be on statewide TV, guys. Any numbers? What do you reckon it could be? Well, there is, believe it or not, an exact number. Is believe it or not, there are 362,880 possible ways to play at noughts and crosses. It's what's called factorial 9. I worked out once, that's 9 by 8 by 7 by 6 by 5. Huge number. Worked out once, if you played noughts and crosses 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you'd be still playing in 13 months' time. You wouldn't have much of a life. Probably says a lot about my life to actually want to work something like that out. But it's a hell of a lot of noughts and crosses. But what happens is that I probably played it that way once and I won. 10 games later, I fluked it again. 40 games later, fluked it again. God, I always win when I play this way. So that becomes my way of playing noughts and crosses. But as soon as I lock onto that one way, I automatically lock off all these other options here. Right? So, law two. Law two says, if you want to go from this current view of the situation over here to the better view of the situation, you've really got to have something that's going to tempt you. Okay, so wall to here. This is my current view. How about my life, my finances, my family, and I'm getting there. And a friend of mine says, Laurie, that's pretty good, but if you want to come here, that's better. And I'm going to say, oh, I don't know, like it's all right, 60, 65%. Chance I'm not going to move. They say, listen, here's your current view here, but over here's a better view, okay? That is going to tempt me to shift, okay? That is something that is at least 10 times better than what I currently believe. That's what I mean by BVS, okay? Now, folks, I start most of my workshops this way, okay? Because what I'm going to say to you is that I'm going to guarantee you in the next half hour, and then the other sessions we have today, that there will be some BVSs, as in all the other presentations and deliveries and sessions that have been on today. Okay? There'll be BVSs here for us, but we've got to be open to it. Can I ask, has anyone ever come across Brain Gym? You've come across Brain Gym? Brain Gym's a series of exercises they use with kids in primary school. I come across Brain Gym back in 1985. Okay? My business partner with the very first course in Brain Gym in Australia came back on the Monday morning to our high school staff room and she was excited. She said, oh, she said, I've been in the most wonderful workshop. She said, all we've got to do is get kids to do this, she said, and that's going to solve dyslexia in the school. We thought, oh God, she's been to another workshop. She's as high as a kite, as if that could help anyone with dyslexia. Yeah, so give her a hard time as true professionals would. And then she says, Laurie, there's a brilliant exercise for maths. Well, I was now a maths teacher, you know, humanities trained. I was teaching maths. I thought, I'm desperate. What do I do? She said, it's wonderful. They'll just love their maths. I said, just show me. This is it, guys. If you want to improve your maths or your kids' maths, she said, you've got to get the kids to put their feet apart like this, bring your arm up like this, look along like this, like it's an elephant's trunk. Then she said, all you've got to do is get kids to do great big lazy ace like that, she said, and that's really good for mathematics. And I said, bullshit. Okay. That could help anyone with math. I could just see my grade 9 boys doing this. You know, they're like, God, the last thing I need. Thank you very much. 30 years later, most of my master's studies in the area, I'm convinced that's a brilliant exercise for maths. I now know why it works. I know why these cool muscles here affect what part of the neocortex up here when it comes to maths thinking. Okay? But guys, I guess I'm saying that some of the stuff here that's going to sound as queer as this, all I ask is that you don't judge me too early. Okay? That there will be stuff here that I know will work. Okay? And I don't share this one very often, but you guys are educators. Del gave up on the staff. She went outside and she thought, I'll try one of the kids. And there was this little kid called Lachlan. I still remember this kid. He's a little grade 8 kid. If he was here, his books would be the fire in the playground. You know, if he was over there, his books would be there. One of these kids had never got it together. And Del went outside. This sounds awful, but you'll understand what I'm talking about. She said, I saw Lachlan and she thought, well, I can't do a lot of damage. So she says, can I do some exercises with you? And he says, yeah, all right, missed, you know. He didn't know where he was supposed to be anyway. So she did some exercises with him. He came back and she said she's walking up the classroom a few periods later, and this Lachlan come run up the veranda with one of his friends and he said, Miss, he said, I feel so good. He said, will you do me mate? And so she did his mate and then his mate's mate and all these kids wanting to get done. Now, none of us believed it, but something was happening. Yeah, placebo effect. They thought it worked, so therefore it was working. But we then released Del, voted to release Del for a day and a half a week just to do kids because something was happening. So I guess I'm asking is just be open. There's some ideas here. So let's get underway. If you can turn the next page over, there should be a wizard there. Now, this is about what happens, or where do we get our thoughts from? Well, we get them from what I call our beliefs or our thinking. Now, let me here is just get you to imagine here in the middle here is my self-image, how I see myself. Now, let's say that I have a self-image about myself that I believe that I am average at tennis. Going to have a hit round, never going to play Wimbledon. I'm just a very average, ordinary social tennis player. Now, at the back of my head, in what is called the old reptilian brain, okay, is located the RAS, the reticular activation system. Now, the RAS has a very particular job. It limits out from our conscious and our subconscious thinking, okay? So its job is to keep what we call a comfort zone around our thoughts. So it only allows in to our conscious thinking those things it reinforces, it recognises. It's a filter, right? So what happens, I go out to play tennis, I'm aware when I miss the serve, I'm aware when I hit the net, I'm aware when I hit the baseline. And I think, wow, you know, it doesn't matter, you know, maybe only average anyway. Then one game I go to play tennis, instead of playing an average game, I play an absolute blinder. My friends come back and say, gee, that was good. Why don't you play club tennis, you know? You'd at least be great. You could be playing the comp. Now, all that sort of comment from them is so totally counter what I believe, I normally go straight into denial. I say, yeah. But what about my second serve? I faltered that one. I played 2.5 hours of brilliant tennis, but I lock on to the one thing in the whole game that keeps me average, because that's where I'm comfortable. Go out to play next week. If I still believe I'm average, I most likely play a shocker. And I say, oh, well, I knew it was a fluke. I knew I couldn't play like that again. Have you heard yourself say those sort of things? Okay. That's the RAS kicked in. Okay. Now we said, okay, well, where do we get our thinking from? Okay. Now, the RAS, it's like, I guess, the RAS doesn't know what is real or what's not real. All it knows is what you tell it. Okay. So if I gave you a board this wide and put on the floor between that ball there and that ball there and said, okay, folks, walk along it. That's pretty easy, isn't it? Okay. If I put that same board between two 20-story buildings, 20 stories up there, 20 stories up there, and said, okay, folks, walk along it. What would happen to most people in the population? a little bit shaky, a little bit nervous, I'm going to be down, I'm going to be down, your hands, and you absolutely hold on. 3 hours later, same board. Okay, my mind said, I'm going to fall off. So the RAS says, okay, I'll make sure you do. That's my job. Remember when you rode a bike, or your mum or dad or your older brother or sister got beside you and they were your human training wheels, and you started right off, they let go and you pedal a bit further, and all of a sudden you swung around, no one was holding on. What happened? Stacked it. Yeah, can't ride this without someone holding on. You rode it for 20 metres, but didn't know. And then you're a bit good at riding a bike, a bit cocky. Okay, mum takes you down the bike track, down the oval. She says, look, right out there on the oval, get plenty of practice, heaps of space. Just be careful that tree over there in the corner. You know what happened. Might have been 20 minutes, but it gotcha, okay, because my mum said. Okay? Now, we then say, okay, so where do we get these beliefs from, or these thinking from? We get them from what I call wizards. Now, these are people in our lives who have been very influential. It's like in The Wizard of Oz, there was a tin man, and the tin man believed he didn't have a heart. Can anyone remember what the wizard gave him to replace his heart? Sorry. Thump, thump, thump. Come on, a clock, okay? Gave him a clock, okay? And we're not believing he had a heart. Lion thought he was a coward, so he gave him a certificate of courage. We're not to be the king of the jungle. Now, we've all had these wizards. Some of these people have been absolutely brilliant. It may have been a coach who said to you once, this is your sport, go for it, you've got huge potential. Another coach who says, look, don't get your hopes too high. There's going to be a lot of competition out there today. Just go out and enjoy yourself. If you get up, that's good. If not, doesn't matter. Bang. Don't think I'm good enough. It's not what the coach said. It's what you've taken on. So, folks, can I just get you to think about who have been some of the wizards that we've all had in our lives? And I guess people who are out there in the regions, just to think about who have been some of your wizards. We've all had. Okay? Someone just said parents. Absolutely, parents. Both good and sometimes limiting. Teachers. Both good and sometimes limiting. Coaches. Siblings. Can I put family there? Because it's easier to spell. Okay? But also includes grandma, who says, yeah, oh, you're just like your dad. He couldn't do maths either. And you say, oh, it's genetic. It's in my blood. It's in my DNA. It's got nothing to do with your DNA whatsoever. More likely you come home in grade 2 and you got 7 out of 10 for a maths test, you know. Bit teary, you lost 3 marks. These days you'd be pretty happy if you only lost 3 marks. Anyway, bit teary. And then it says, don't worry, darling, your dad couldn't do maths either. You're going to be like him. Bang, you've taken it on. Okay? What's some others? Managers. Managers, bosses, supervisors, colleagues. Friends, definitely. Could be authority figures like doctors. For you guys, it could also be things like media. Could be hero figures. It could be partners. It could be ex-partners. That could be the first love of your life growing up, can be a pretty strong wizard. It can be your own kids. Having 5 of my own, not always positive. Okay, come on, what's the biggest wizard, bud? Biggest wizard of the lot. We haven't got it yet.
Yourself.
Thank you, excellent. It's our self. Now, the secret to this stuff, when looking at possibility thinking, is that this RAS does not know what is real or what is not real. All it knows is what you tell it, okay? So, if I give you a couple of examples here so that you can get them, then we're going to do a couple ourselves. I had a young guy, probably when I was high school teaching, nearly 23 years ago now. He was probably the best sportsman in the year group, if not the school, okay? And he said to me, he was trying to get into the Institute of Sport. And he said, I've got to pass maths to get into the Institute. He's a baseball player. And I said, what are you getting? And he said, I'm getting 34%. I said, okay, now that means you've used 5% of brain's potential and you've got 34 marks. It means you have the 95% of brain power here to go and you've only got to get 14 marks. So do you think that's possible if we could tap into the other 95% of the brain? He said, oh, yeah, I suppose it is. I said, good, as long as you're open to it. So we then started to look at his wizards, where his thinking had come from. Okay, and track back to his grade two teacher. And this lady probably said this to 100 kids or 200 kids. 199 couldn't have cared less. This one kid took it on. She said, Mark, if you don't do your maths homework, you're never ever going to be any good at maths. Now, most kids just say, who cares, you know? But this little kid says, I didn't do my maths homework, therefore, I'm never ever, 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 ever going to be able to do maths. Mrs. Key Concepts and Primary School couldn't understand it, year 8. I said, do you seriously believe that one night in year one or year two is going to affect you for the rest of your life in maths because you didn't do your homework? He said, oh, don't be silly. One night, how could one night affect any kid in grade two? I said, well, don't let it. It's just a thought. Cut a long story short, okay, I was in the staff room and his results come in. He got 93% at the end of the year. Okay, now he had tutoring before and he had tutoring afterwards. The thing was he started questioning his wizards. Who said I can't do this? Now, there is a whole heap of things that we can start to challenge. I'll give one last example. This lady said to me, at the end of a conference, she said, I know my wizard. I said, who is it? She said, my father. I said, well, what happened? She said, he always used to say, I don't finish things. And she said, I'm not a finisher. I said, okay. I said, where does it start? She said, well, I left school, started uni, dropped out at Easter. And Dad said, that's typical of you. You never finish anything you start. 27, my marriage broke up. Dad gave it to me again. You never finish anything you start. Said, I was 37, she said, and she said, I struggle to finish stuff. He said, I just do stuff right then just to prove him wrong. Stuff I don't want to do, I don't need you to, but I just got to finish it. Trouble is, he's been dead for 3 years. I said, that's the thought process. She happened to be the boss's secretary of this huge organisation. I said, I finished a conference. You finish up all the speakers. You organise that, a combination. What about annual reports, annual meeting, minutes of meeting? I finished all that sort of stuff. We went through, there were probably about 6 or 7 things in the last 12 months she hadn't finished, but thousands of things she did finish. Okay, but she was looking for, I'm not a finisher. Right? So I want to challenge you on this, how this works for yourselves and then with your students. So could I ask you very quickly to write down for me, please, what is a belief system that you have about money? What did mum and dad tell you about money? Just jot that down for me. The thought, like money doesn't grow on trees. Well, you can't really use that one. I've just used that one, okay? You got to come up with another one. Next one. Can I get you to write down for me, please? What is a thought that you had when you first started school, or first started work, right? What did mum and dad or your guardian tell you about work? What's the shoulds or the should nots of the workplace? Should or you should not do when you started work? Let's shut down. What advice did they give you about work? Okay, next one. What's a belief system that you hear students use that may limit them in their potential? Things like, I can't do that. I've never been any good at school. Okay? I couldn't possibly get through that amount of reading. I can't spell. What are some of the limiting things that you hear students use? See, again, the RAS doesn't know what's real or what's not real. All it knows is what you tell it. Last one. I want you to write down for me, and even people out in the regions, if you could write this down for me, it helps your thinking as well. What do you say about car salesmen? Jot that down for me. What do you say about car salesmen? What's your thinking about car salesmen? Okay, can I very, very quickly just get a little bit of feedback. I'm just really conscious of time here. About money. Can I ask here, Trish, what did your folks tell you about money? Money is the root of all evil. Now, if it's the root of all evil, what would you want in your life, you know? Thank you very much. Yes, please.
Never have enough.
Never have enough. There'll never be enough money. Okay, great, thank you.
Okay.
Never be enough. Yeah, you don't even ask. Okay, great, thank you.
You need to
save, because you might need it one day. It's not guaranteed to be there forever. Okay, good. You've got to work hard to have money. Now, if you had a belief like that, it would be very difficult to have a passive income, because you're not working hard for it. Can you see what I'm talking about? Okay. Now, these sorts of stuff actually affect our thinking. Okay. Anyone else have a different one about money?
People who've got a lot of it probably
doing
something dodgy.
All right, okay. So you've got a lot of money, you're obviously doing something dodgy with that, okay? Okay. All right, I'm just we're 5 minutes to go.
Two online,
yes, please. Thank you.
So Stephanie said it doesn't grow on trees.
Right, excellent.
And Shana said money makes money.
Okay, all right, good. Okay. Now, you may or may not know the stats on this one. What they do is they survey people who won lotto, okay, to see how they're going 5 years after winning lotto. The Australian figures are between 79 to 83% of people who have won lotto are in exactly the same financial position 5 years after winning lotto as what they were before. Okay, that's pretty staggering. So now every one of us will think, well, we'd love to win lotto on Saturday night. Well, I'm saying if you do, there's going to be a 79 to 83% chance you're going to be in the same position you are now. So if you're wealthy, you'll still be wealthy. If you're poor, you'll be back to being poor. If you say, no, it won't be me, I'm saying, Sarah will be. Like, if you had a belief, money's made round to go round. Don't be mean with your money. Share your money out. All these sorts of stuff kick in for us, okay? I actually had a lady say to me once that her friend had went through $2 million in lotto, okay, in 6 months. She'd won $2 million, went through the whole lot in 6 months. I thought, my God, what happened? She said, it was really funny. She said, bought a new car for one guy. He'd smashed it, and so she hadn't insured it, so she put him another one. She bought one of her kids a new house. The only thing she actually finished up with was her home unit, which she was renting, now she owns. I said, she must be devastated. She said, she is so happy. I said, why is she happy? She said, this sounds funny, but now she can get the pension again. So her belief system was, I can cope with the pension. I'm okay where I am. Last one, I had one very interesting one. I was listening to the radio. I thought, gee, this bloke sounds old. And the announcer must have thought the same. He was ringing up for investment advice. And he said, Bill, can I ask how old you are? And he says, I'm 92. He says, but I want to have enough money put aside for the old age. God, at 92, he wants to live a long time. He couldn't enjoy himself even at 92. And you know where it's come from. The depression and all sorts of stuff that's kicked in. So, folks, what I want to do in the time we've got is, how do you free this up? Okay? How is it? And this is what I want you to be able to do with your students. And very much it can be in your thinking process. Okay? Now, what I need from somebody, please, is someone who has, and I do not want to know the goal. Okay? But have we got anyone who has got a goal that's not coming for them as fast as they would like it to? Excellent. Trish, could I get you to come down here? Be on camera with me. I don't want to know your goal, right? Come on down. You'll be right. All right, now, Trish, have you been muscle checked by a chiropractor or kinesiologist?
No.
Okay, I'll show you what this is. Get your arm up here for me. Get your arm locked for me, just like that. Okay, good. Just say for me, my name is Trish.
My name is Trish.
Hold. Good. So my name is Betty.
My name is Betty.
Hold. Oh, can we just go? Now, that's a muscle check, folks. When your brain's going, what's going on here? It's not Betty. So the arm just goes down. It's a bit like this one here. Let your arm lock for me. Hold. This is what's called energy meridian. Hold. That's nice and firm, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If I cross it across like that, hold. Nothing there. Okay. Up again. Hold. Good. Now, that's a pathway. Like in martial arts, they talk about that a lot of exercise, and Tai Chi come with this exercise here. It's lifting up energy. It's a great way of picking up your own energy. That's the switched on, switched off muscle. Right? Now, think about your goal for me. Okay, got your goal. It's not coming for you as fast as you'd like. Just say for me, this is hard work.
This is hard work.
Hold. Oh, too difficult for me.
Too difficult for me.
Hold. Won't be able to do it.
I won't be able to do it.
Hold. Now, each of those negative states are blowing your energy. Mm-hmm. What I'd like you to say to me, I believe it'll be hard. But that may not be true.
But that may not be true.
Hold. Oh, a bit of a difference here. I believe it'll be too difficult. But that may not be true.
But that may not be true.
Hold. Too hard. Just say too hard.
Too hard.
Now, see the difference?
Doing it,
Now, I'm not going around and saying, rah, rah, be positive. I'm saying it's challenging your thinking. It's challenging this belief system. Thanks, Trish.
Mm-hmm.
Now, 99% of Trisha's experience might be it's really hard to achieve that goal. But as soon as you say, but that may not be true, you allow the comfort zone to open. Now, in your book here, I've got here, focus. Okay. This is what I really want you as educators to pick up with your students. Okay. As soon as you, and you will hear this. So I'm just going to ask you here to put what we call negative self-talk. As soon as you hear someone say, I can't, I won't be able to, too difficult, just to follow it with, but. That may not be true. I'm too bored. That may not be true. I've never been able to get any good at school. Yeah, but that may not be true. I'm not smart enough for that. But that may not be true. Right? Now, I'm going to suggest that you start this with your own family and your team around you. Okay? As soon as you hear someone say something negative, you say, yeah, but that may not be true. Then they'll say something else. You say, yeah, but that may not be true. And then until anything you hear, until you get fair up people's nose, right? Fair up their nose. Then you'll say one negative statement, and everyone in your family and your team will be on you like a ton of bricks, but that may not be true. And that's what you want to do. You want to catch your self-talk. Your RAS doesn't know what's real or what's not real. All it knows is what you tell it. Right? Now, this is really very, very important that we start to kind of challenge thinking, because this is where we get the possibility. We get caught in old patterns. Okay? And our RAS focuses in the old pattern. By doing this, but that may not be true, you open up options. You open up the brain to look for possibilities. Okay? So folks, can I get you to look at the next one? This page here. It's called How to Kill Ideas and Chloroform Thinking. And I want you just to see if you've ever heard one of these. I'll read some of these out for the people out in the regions. Number one, we've never done it that way before. It won't work. It's not part of our job. We haven't got the time. Too expensive. Let's be practical. Number 13, let's form a committee. Okay. Okay. So how to stop ideas in chloroform thinking. 30 of them there. I give this page out Australia-wide to private and public organisations. And people say, that was last week's staff meeting. Okay. Now what happens is this stuff's out there. All I'm saying to you guys is be careful. Don't get hooked by it. So it's a challenge for you as you work with your students, but it's also a challenge for you in your own lives, you know. We get hooked by these old patterns, okay? Now, I'm very aware that of the time factor, so I'm going to ask you to look at the third law, all right? So I've given you the two laws. This is back to our third law of thinking. And one of the things that I maintain is that whenever I do a workshop, I really want people to leave with a really useful skill that works. Okay? So law three. Now this activity is going to take you 1 minute, 40 seconds daily for the next 10 days. Now if it doesn't work after 10 days, give it away. Okay, but I want you just to say for me, CVS, current view of the situation to BVS, current view to better view. I'm going to ask you to do that 100 times daily for the next 10 days. Okay, so current view to better view, current view to better view, current view to better view. Okay, now if you're thinking to yourself, it takes about a minute and 40 seconds. If you think to yourself, well, why would rational adults be going around saying current view to better view 100 times a day? Can I give you this analogy? If you were to go to any car yard and buy yourself a brand new yellow Mazda, I will guarantee you, the minute you get in your brand new yellow Mazda and drive out in the road, you are going to see yellow Mazdas like it everywhere. Would you agree with that? Okay. Now, the yellow Mazdas have always been there, but you've never seen them before. And all of a sudden, there's another one. They're everywhere. Well, the fact is they are everywhere, but we're not focusing on them. The better views are the same. The BVSs are everywhere, but we don't look for them. Now, folks, the thing is that you'd sound very dorky when you do this the first time, okay? So we're going to be dorks together. So people in here I know are being dorks because I can hear them, but the people out there in the regions, could I just ask you, have a bit of fun with this, to get the brain open to ideas here, okay? So I'm going to ask you to do this 10 times, folks. 5 times in shorthand, 5 times in longhand. We'll do current for you to better be 5 times, then CVS to BVS 5 times. Okay, so remember I'm a teacher, ex-teacher, so I can pick on the ones who aren't speaking. Nice and loud, guys. 1, 2, 3. Current for you to better view. Louder. Current for you to better view. Current for you to better view. Current for you to better view. Current for you to better view there. CVS to BVS. CVS to BVS. CVS to BVS. BVS. CVS to BVS. You've only got another 90 to do today. Okay. Now, what I'm suggesting, do it for about 10 days. My experience is that about day 6, you'll be working on something and the brain will just think, ah, that's a good idea. You'll just be talking to someone, okay? And you'll just think, ah. It's just like all of a sudden your brain's looking for alternatives, looking for options. You'll be working on a project and your mind will just say, BVS. Ah, there's got to be another way of doing this, okay? So can I, again, suggest you take this for about 10 days. If it works, you'll keep doing it. If it doesn't, that's not for you. Okay? But it's just another way of getting your brain looking for options, looking for ideas. Because so easy we can get caught in the negative. So easy we can set up our brain to watch this negative self-talk. Oh. There. Okay. Folks, I hope that's been some possibility. I'm really aware of the time and I'm really aware that I didn't cover everything I wanted to. I really wanted you to hop up and actually do some muscle work, but for those out in the regions, just have a play with this. And I'm, our time's going to run out in a sec, so I'm happy to work with those people in the room here and show you some of that stuff for yourselves. But it's just our body and our words are interrelated. It's very often the words we use can affect our energy. Okay? And I guess what I'm suggesting with your students is that you set them up to be open to options, open to possibilities, and not get caught down by that past experience that they've had. Looking for the better view. Thank you very much.
Authorised by the Government of Western Australia, Perth.